Jupiter at Night is filmed before a live internet audience.
Good evening, everyone, and welcome to Jupiter at Night. My name is Chris.
My name is Jeremy.
Now, this episode is going to be all about saving time.
And wasting it.
Yeah, now, we know that might sound a little weird coming from a daily podcast that steals 15 minutes of your time.
Think how much of your time we have already wasted if you're tuning in more than once.
And boy, don't think about that. But really, we try to give you information. We try to give you maybe different opinions on topics.
You know, and on previous shows, we've already talked about some things like how much time the human race has spent on Facebook and Google Pac-Man. So we thought, that's an interesting topic.
It is, yeah.
We're going to dig a little more into that.
So we'll get into some ways that Jupiter Night will actually save you time. Should we cover some of those?
Yeah.
All right.
Well, I think one of the first things that I've got here set aside for us to play with is actually just an infographic that shows how the average person spends their day.
This is really interesting. So we're all really busy folks,
everybody.
Obviously. So if you look at this graphic that the J-Man here found, this comes from the New York Times,
mm-hmm.
and we'll have a link to it in our show notes. It's an interactive graph of what people do. Along the bottom, I know it's a little hard to see in the video version, along the bottom...
And I don't think that my flash is working correctly on this
browser.
I'll pull
it up over here.
Yeah.
On the bottom, we've got the time of day that it is. So between 6 a.m. and 3 a.m.
Yep.
And then you've got the percentile along the top. So you can see this big orange section is how much people work. So you audio listeners here...
And the thick grayish-white area on the left and right-hand side is sleeping.
An epic amount of sleeping.
Mm-hmm.
And you can break it down to age ranges so we can see like how men spend their time and they're in the ages of 25 and 64. Mm-hmm. Really interesting stuff.
Yeah.
So this is a great setup for the topics that we'll be covering today.
Yep.
Now, up first, before we get into ways to waste time, because that's where all the fun is, let's talk about maybe some ways to save time. And I've got a couple of unique tips that I've been applying to myself.
First, I want to tell a story.
Okay.
I want to tell the people at home, after I get attacked by a fly...
Sorry about that.
A little bit about myself.
We have the door open.
You guys are going to learn probably more about me than you want to. But basically what it comes down to is I don't deal with stress very well.
Yeah. Well, people do.
It makes me extremely cranky.
Yeah.
And if I get too much on my plate at any time, I just simply shut off.
Yeah.
I'm not one of these type of people that when I get stressed and under the gun, I'll get done what I can get done. I don't get a single damn thing done.
Yeah, because it's like, where do I start?
Right.
Yeah, I understand that.
So when things start to pile up so much, so my entire life has become sort of this balancing act between being stressed and procrastinating.
Mm. I know what you mean, because it's...
A lot of these tips that you've got written in here, I need to just follow these, because it would be so much more efficient to spend my time doing this rather than just piling up all my procrastination and shutting down.
I'm exactly like that. And so I've built sort of like this framework of efficiency rules that I try to follow, because otherwise... If I don't see a clear path to win,
mm-hmm.
and if I don't see a clear starting point, it's just like this nebulous amount of work that is very...
And then you just sit there
stressful.
And build up the rage because you know you have to get to something, but you don't know where to start, and then it's all this
vicious
cycle.
And so then what you need, then you wait for the deadline for that final motivation, because that'll be the thing that makes that one task the most important above all of the noise.
Mm-hmm.
So a couple of these tips are just to help you get information and move on quickly. I'll start with search.twitter.com. Even if you are not a Twitter user, if you've never tweeted in your life, go to search.twitter.com, because what you can do is you can search the collective brain for information.
This is something I hadn't thought of. I actually asked Chris, why would you want to add a tool to your life when you're trying to save time? But if you're trying to look for something that is up to the minute, immediate...
Super, super instant information.
You can't look for that on Google.
Mm-mm.
Google's not going
to
have it.
They have to index it. It takes them a while.
Exactly.
And a lot of us have phones with internet connections, like mm-hmm. a cell phone. And a great example is I have Verizon Fios here. And one night, I'm up late working on a show, and I was uploading it, and our Fios went out. Fios almost never goes out, but it goes out every mm-hmm. now and then. And I was like, well, now what do I do? Jumped on my phone, went to Google, searched for Verizon Fios status. Nothing. So went to try to go to Verizon's page. Nothing. Then it dawned on me.
Sidebar, Verizon has a terrible website. And if you guys are in the business of providing data communication, maybe you could start with your website.
Yeah. Yeah. Help us communicate better with you with a better designed website.
Okay, go on.
That's for real, too. So it dawned on me I could go over to search.twitter.com. I search in Verizon Fios outage in Marysville. I get like 15 responses instantly.
Other people in this area going, oh, crap, my Fios just dropped.
On the same thing I'm doing.
So at least then you know that it's not your account.
I've expanded it beyond that, too. So now, like, today I picked up an Evo 4G, the new Android Evo 4G. I'll be talking about that on this week's Linux Action Show. A lot of you have been Twittering me questions. You can Twitter me. If you have questions about the Evo 4G, twitter.com/ChrisLES. Check Sunday for that. So they are really hard to find right now, these Evo 4G.
Yeah, they're out of stock everywhere.
Sold out, dude.
Yeah.
And so jumped on Twitter. And now on Twitter, you can also search by region. It gets geolocation involved. Mm-hmm. And I just searched for my area for who had the phone in stock. I saw a Twitter message. Just got out of the store. They have the Evo still in stock. I called them up and I said, put one on hold for me, and I ran down there. And so Twitter search can be a very powerful tool without ever even actually having to use Twitter.
Yeah, so that's a way that you can save yourself some time.
Another way you can save time is use a news reader like Google Reader, NetNewsWire, NetVibes,
or even several apps that come out. If you've got a handheld device, there are several apps you can choose
from.
Good
ones.
Yeah.
The reason I say that is a lot of us have daily routines that we visit websites.
Mm-hmm.
If you consolidate all that into one spot, like Google Reader, you can pull in all the feeds and check one spot to get all your information.
This dweeb got me hooked on Google Reader, which now you guys know we use for our show and everything like that. But before that, I used to have probably 12 different websites I would go, and I would forget to go to some of them sometimes, but now I've got everything in one feed. So when I load up my browser and it's time to basically read my newspaper, I just click on the reader, and I can get my entire feed from every one of those websites consolidated and categorized. So if I want to submix or sub-search in any particular category, I can easily do so.
Yep. It's very nice for, like, oh, I remember hearing about this story. Let me go search for this real quick.
Yeah.
And now, because I think your brain works a little bit like mine, because in this point along, we've been really good boys so far, mm-hmm. we need to reward ourselves a little bit. So I save a couple of sites off to the side that I intentionally don't put in my Google Reader because sometimes I honestly like to kill time and go browse the site. And I don't know what it is, but Engadget is one of those sites where I actually prefer to see Engadget in the web browser than I do Reader. So I intentionally keep Engadget and Dig.com out of my Reader.
I'm addicted to web comics. I'm always finding those. And many of those have RSS feeds. I could put them in my reader.
There's a great built-in Google-featured comics reader.
That's my little
thing. Yeah, exactly.
That's my little time
waster.
Whereas,
see, for me, comics aren't as much of my daily routine. So I subscribe to a bundle in Google Reader for
right.
that. Yeah, it's interesting. I'm going to skip down the list a little bit here because we'll have a bunch in the show notes of mm-hmm. my personal ones. One thing I want to mention, because this works really well for me, it's really a mindset thing. A lot of times, you know, we do Brian Lunduke's Jupiter Files in the morning.
Mm-hmm.
That airs at 7 a.m. Pacific. But I actually, you know, I'm generally up. So if that's at 7, I'm usually up by 6:30, getting the studio ready, getting, you know, anything I need to get done ready.
Yeah.
So I could start my day right then and there. Mm-hmm. And the mindset would be, I'm going to start my day, my work day now. I'll get even more done because I'll be starting at 7 a.m. instead of 8 a.m. or 6:30.
But then if you're still planning to end the day at 6 p.m.
you're going to burn yourself out.
That's a 12-hour work day.
So I try to go into every single day with, I have, my personal goal is 6 hours. I try to give myself 6 hours to get my planned work done.
Now, disclaimer, you're in a line of work that not everybody out there can do that.
Right. But if you go into the office in the morning, you're like, God, I really got to get this done and I got to get this done.
Mm-hmm.
Think of it in the context of, I only have so many hours. If you convince yourself of an artificial deadline, it helps with that procrastination motivator.
Yeah, I take that point one step further. If you don't have a deadline for a project that you do need to be working on, set your own.
Make one.
Yeah.
A lot of times internally at Jupiter Broadcasting, we will set a release date or a goal just so that way we have a motivation and a target to hit. Because if mm-hmm. there's not a clearly defined target for us to hit, that will float and it just keeps getting pushed out.
Especially if you're the type of person that has several balls juggling in the air at the same time, mm-hmm. because then that allows you to prioritize your daily schedule so that you can set up, well, I know this one has a shorter deadline, so I got to spend Tuesday evening, 6 to 8 p.m. doing that.
And then lastly, just I'm probably skipping about half the tips, but I just want to touch on a couple of my favorites here. This one's a weird one I threw in there. What'd you think of this? Clean your air with plants.
Well, this kind of goes back to like psychochemistry.
Make your environment, you know,
clean,
mentally clean.
Yeah.
Clean air. Add things to your house, into your life that will automate processes for
mm-hmm.
you. plants, you know, they liven it up, they freshen the air up. Roombas are automated vacuums. Maybe
and
even
your dogs probably would love chasing a Roomba. Yeah.
And so would Dylan, my 1-year-old son. Also consider, if you can afford it, hiring cleaners. Think mm-hmm. of it as your personal time and your work time. Try to associate a dollar amount with that. And
how much is your personal time worth?
Yeah, and not everyone could afford that option, so I'm just putting that out
right.
there. But you can do things like plants and self-cleaning this and that and all this different stuff that mm-hmm. you will help save time to get those chores done. Also, a personal favorite of mine for house chores is audiobooks. Helps a lot.
So you can listen to them while you're doing something else. If you can find ways to easily multitask in your day without losing... You know, there have been a lot of studies that came out basically that people are losing their focus a lot when they're online.
Yeah.
So be careful of that, because that is actually a detractor to your efficiency. Mm-hmm. If you can't focus on anything, then you're not getting anything
done. If it's
done.
A real problem for you too, there's a lot of browser extensions out there for pretty much every browser that will actually start to giving you a virtual smack over the head if you spend too much time, like on Facebook. It'll have like a little counter that says, you spent 60 minutes on Facebook this morning.
Mm-hmm.
You should probably go do something
else.
You
big old slacker.
And you're like, oh... Yeah, I should. Now,
stop
I don't,
weeding your Farmville garden and
I,
go do
I
something
personally
important.
Don't use that extension because, well, I don't want to tell me I'm wasting my time.
Right, because if you're spending that much time, you have that time to waste.
Yeah.
But on that subject of software that can help you use your time more wisely, I want to point you guys to the show notes. We have a link to this thing called Hotkey.
Oh, AutoKey, yeah.
AutoKey.
That's a great time saver. And there's a Windows version, a Linux version. Mac users, go check out Text Expander.
Mm-hmm.
This is nuts, people.
This
nuts.
This is like for really easy tasks that you do a lot on your computer that usually take you, I don't know, maybe it's only 30 seconds.
Oh, yeah.
Maybe and it's only 15 seconds.
I
but
resisted
if you do that
this
like
for a long
five,
time.
6 times a day, that adds up. If you do that same thing 4 or 5 days a week mm-hmm. that many times, that's a lot of time that you're wasting that you could automate through this sort of thing by just clicking a single button.
Here's how I use it. So I actually actively use these programs every single day.
Mm-hmm.
So like when I'm composing an email, if I type /GVN, it automatically replaces /GVN with my Google Voice phone number. And I
nice.
Can do /thank you, and it automatically inputs my thank you signature with contact.
That you use for your workplace.
Yeah, yeah. But I also have a lot for Jupiter Broadcasting, where I'll be doing show notes stuff where it's the same block of HTML mm-hmm. every time. I can just do the slash, you know, whatever I call that description, and automatically inputs all of the code for me. So for coders, this is a really big one. You can even use these AutoKey programs and Text Expander to correct spelling mistakes,
mm-hmm.
All kinds of stuff. And you don't have to spend a ton of time setting these up, because a lot of them, you can get preset bundles for key combos, which is sweet, because then you just drop in and go.
The story that I've linked in our show notes is actually a very dumbed down. This was written by a guy that's not a programmer. Mm. He's like a philosophy major. And he uses this for college homework and stuff like that. So it's very easy to use for the entry-level folks. And if you have automated tasks that you want to make even more automated.
That's a great one. I know it seems like it's funny, because one of the ways we really, I feel, save time is by making all of these little small adjustments that add up. And that's mm-hmm. that's actually a really big one, and it pays off. It keeps paying off.
You know, and that actually leads back to another point that we skipped higher up, that was to make lists and automate things.
Yeah.
And if you have a regular task that you perform on a repeated basis, and you find that each time you do it, you're either forgetting something, or you're leaving something out, or it's just taking too much of your time. Even if the first setup...
Make a checklist.
Yeah. Or not even a checklist, but using this, you could set up some sort of automated process that even if it takes you hours and hours to set up this process... From then on out, you're saving time.
That's my rule of thumb.
And down the long run, it might make you more efficient.
If I have to repeat something more than once or twice, I'll look at what it would take to make it automated or easier versus how much time it would take to do that. And mm-hmm. if I have to repeat a process once or twice, I'm very likely to put the upfront time in so that every time I go to repeat that task, I have a payoff.
Yep.
And that's this AutoKey and Text Expander are great for that.
Yep.
Now, I just feel like we got really productive on everyone. And this is an evening show, so we should probably cover a few ways.
You're probably just kicking back and relaxing. Yeah. So
there's got to be some ways people are wasting time out there. A couple of fun ones.
Everybody watches television, right?
Everybody watches television.
Stop it. Podcasts are better.
They are. Think about all the information you're getting right now. So, there was this really crazy infographic.
You want me to try to pull it up over here?
Yeah, if you got it over there. Now prepare yourselves for potentially life-crushing, depressing news when you look at the amount of time spent watching TV versus the amount of time working on Wikipedia. Now, the amount of time watching TV is a giant blue block.
I can't
in this
even fix it on the screen behind us.
No, I know. It's the amount of time watching TV is so much larger than the amount of time editing Wikipedia that we'll actually have to do a special zoom-in shot here. So let me get that set up for you guys.
Now, keep in mind that Wikipedia is largely believed to be like the pinnacle of gathering human knowledge. This is the collective conscious of the human race.
So there it is. Now,
and that's how much time it has taken to put that thing together.
That's it. So
that's that little box.
Humans have spent roughly, 200 billion hours a year watching TV, and we've spent a grand total of 100 million working on Wikipedia.
Ever. Like, since it first came out.
So if you can, maybe cut out some of the TV.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe.
You know, actually, a good tip that we had in our lists earlier is to, if anything that you can replace by just sitting passively in front of a television with on-demand media,
mm-hmm.
for one thing, you'll cut out your time because you won't be watching as many commercials. And for another, you won't end up watching crap that you wouldn't want to watch unless you were sitting in front of your television.
Mm-hmm.
That happens to me all the time. My parents watch crap on television.
Because it's there.
I know.
Yeah.
Or it's like between two shows that they actually want to watch. So why get up and try to do something in that half-hour block?
Right.
No.
Yeah, well, our show we like is going to be on next. So that is an interesting one. So that's one way that people waste time. And hey, you know what? We're both guilty of that, too.
But what about video games?
This is an interesting one, huh? And you took an interesting approach on this because we were just talking general ways to mm-hmm. kill time. And you found a report here that breaks it down between countries.
Yeah. Well, this is the BBC reports this. As you much might know, that's a British news source.
Ooh.
So it's kind of
hoity-toity,
across the pond.
Oh.
Centric.
No, I kid. I love the BBC. It's actually a pretty good, pretty good news source.
Actually, their US BBC site is really
they rock
in
it,
some
right?
ways better than CNN.
Yeah.
Much better than Fox News. But anyway, I digress. BBC reports that British citizens spent £280 million playing casual online games in 2009.
Great Scott.
Now, £280 million is $430 million. $430 million playing casual games. This is things like Facebook games and mm-hmm. stuff like that. That doesn't even include mobile games
right.
on your iPhones and stuff like that. That was an additional £170 million.
So this is the UK. The French are clocking in at $310 million a year.
That's U.S. dollars, right?
Yep. Germans are clocking in at $685 million. And then the, who's the...
Yeah, no, that's on mobile games in Britland.
In Britland is the... is $260 million.
In the kingdom.
The British in the kingdom over there are spending $260 million on mobile games alone. Just mobile games.
Yeah.
Huge booming market. I really, you know, gaming's a difficult one because you do want to have that balance between play and relaxation. And gaming is a fantastic... I think if you're gonna... Now, you shouldn't probably do TV, movie, and games. You know, you try to have a balance there.
Right.
But it's... Gaming's a great interactive way that feels like it's much less passive than watching TV.
Absolutely.
I'm not like Mr. Anti-TV. I enjoy TV.
No, same here.
But it you do look at these numbers, and it's hard to justify a lot.
You know what I would
time.
Be really curious about is if there are any studies out there that show the difference in stress release between watching television and playing video games. If there is a
Oh, you got to figure.
Because I feel
games are way more stressful, right?
Yes, but it also
rewarding
more easily
too,
gets your mind off your real world stresses
yeah?
because you have to stress on this.
And when you do good in a video game, you have real reward endorphins mm-hmm. released and stuff like that. So you,
yep.
huh.
I think it might work out better
yeah.
in video games' favor.
Yeah, as long as you don't suck.
Yeah. If you suck, it's really stressful.
Hey, you know, speaking of wasting time, I got to say, you guys, this is not really, we're shoehorning the story in, but it's basically because we're blatantly.
It has to do with time, right?
It does have to do with time. We are blatant Back to the Future fans. And if you've been waiting for Back to the Future, the news came out just like yesterday. The Back to the Future trilogy will be coming to Blu-ray.
On October 26th.
Yeah.
And where they're going, they don't need roads.
You know, honestly,
mm-hmm.
aside from Star Trek, this is the series I've been waiting to come on Blu-ray.
We had a big off-the-air discussion like last week or the week before that was like, name the best trilogy ever.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Well, you name the best integrated trilogy from start to end.
It was not based on books.
Right.
And this basically won out. There were a few that would come close. Maybe we were a little
like,
on the fence about it.
Like, as far as trilogies goes, I mean, you can talk Lord of the Rings.
But those are based on books.
Right.
Yeah.
You're just talking pure movie franchises, Back mm-hmm. to the Future. So the fact that it's coming out on Blu-ray, Oh, yeah. I've already pre-ordered it.
Yeah. In fact, I put a link in our show notes for a pre-order link on Amazon.
Hey, yeah. And if you order through that link, you help support the show.
We get like a half percentage. A penny.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Now,
Back to the Future is also becoming an episodic content game made by Telltale Games. And this is kind of an old article, but they're asking for your guys' feedback as Back to the Future fans for the content that you want them to include in this episodic gaming experience.
Oh, well.
So check that link out.
Hoverboard.
Well, yeah.
You got to have the hoverboard.
You got to have the whole train sequence from 3.
And you got to be able to have a DeLorean.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and maybe you could pick up stuff and throw it in your Mr. Fusion. That'd be cool.
Yeah, like you have to refill your DeLorean.
I want the hovering DeLorean.
Yeah.
I don't want the DeLorean with train track wheels.
Oh, no.
Yeah. Now, do you want to cover this story? It's an interesting mind bender. We're moving from time travel to time stretching.
I don't know. This is kind of going to blow everybody's brains up right before they go to bed, I think.
That's true. Well,
I'll do it.
Okay.
I'll do it.
All right. We're sorry if we implode your brain with this one.
And I included this as time because, okay, here we go. There's a story called Ask a Physicist. And the question this time was,
Ask a Ninja only?
Yeah, only okay. A physicist instead of a ninja. It's exactly like that. Only he doesn't kick your face so much. If time is dilated down to the point of infinity at the event horizon of a black hole, which is true, just accept it.
Okay.
How does anything ever enter a black hole?
Right. Because if everything gets stretched, because we've all heard that. We've all heard it gets stretched.
According to the laws of relativity, the gravity near a black hole at the event horizon is so strong that nothing can escape, including light. And many say that basically light is a measure of time.
Mm.
And it's more complicated
than
that.
Okay, now we're blowing my mind. But okay.
It's much more complicated than that. But basically, if everything is slowed down, so to the point where not even light can escape, no time can pass.
Right.
How does anything ever enter into a black hole?
So the gist is,
he didn't answer it.
But he did answer one. I know. But he did answer that. Here's an interesting concept. Say you're just flying towards a black hole.
Mm-hmm.
You wouldn't even the time between when you get torn into atoms and when you feel it is like an instant of a second.
Yeah,
it's like I think he said maybe was it in the milliseconds or
it's
something?
It's 1/10 of a millisecond.
Whoa.
Yeah. So even if you were to commit suicide by jumping into a black hole, you would not feel it.
Fantastic way to commit suicide. It's epic because you die from a black hole.
Yeah.
And it's painless.
So how did Paul? Why Paul's not out here drinking with us? Oh, he jumped into a black hole.
Yeah, he wasn't feeling too
good. Way to go, Paul.
Yeah, he'll be back in 400 years and he'll be evolved. interesting story. If you guys want to just chill out to some really mind-bending stuff, head over to our show notes. The great article.
The one thing I do really love about this article is even though this guy is a physicist, he breaks it down to very basic terms.
Yeah.
Some of the guys in the chat room look like they have some knowledge about black holes. I'd encourage you to read this article because
yeah, you guys will like it.
It's good stuff.
We know it's not everybody's cup of tea, but it is a fun one to end the evening on if you just want to go geek out for a bit and I don't know.
Or have a couple beers. If your brains are melting out your ears right now, I apologize, but I hope you enjoyed it.
Yeah.
Was it good for you?
I liked it.
Okay.
I did enjoy it. Well, okay. So I think that's just about everything we wanted to
cover. Well, we have a few final websites recommendations to waste your time.
Yeah, you guys have probably heard of Fark.com.
I have.
Fark.com is a great site.
This is basically a newsreader you don't have to set up. Yeah. But it's also includes
with Tune.
Everything.
Newsreader with Tune.
Yeah, because they retitle everything that comes through there.
Now, you pointed out download.
Mm-hmm.
DownloadSquad.com.
This is because, let me tell you how I found it. I went to Google Reader, to all of my feeds that are in there, and I typed into the search at the top, time waster. And every single link went to Download Squad.
Download Squad has become one of my daily visits that I have added to Google Reader now because of it. They cover everything from iPhone apps to Linux apps. Mm-hmm. I mean, the whole spectrum.
And you can select by your platform, PC, Mac, Linux, handheld, whatever you want to look up. Plus,
and it's not like download.com. It's not like a two cows or it's a blog with mm-hmm. software reviews, and they just pick a couple
actual
really great
reviews
apps.
And recommendations.
Yeah,
but not only time wasters, some good time savers on there as well. So it's a double-edged recommendation, you might call it.
And of course, if you're always looking for a little bit of infotainment, head over to JupiterBroadcasting.com. We've got all kinds of shows
I've
over there.
Those guys.
Yeah, I hear
they're very handsome.
They do some good stuff, I've been told. The buzz is good on those guys. All right, well, I think now that's just about everything we want to cover in this episode of Jupiter at Night. Now, we are Monday through Thursday, so tomorrow night will be our last show of the week.
But we already have the subject matter lined up.
Yeah.
Tomorrow, we started talking before the show today about retro computer gaming, some of the things that just blow our minds with thinking back on where things were 15 years ago today.
Yeah, we were getting all retro on Netscape Navigator, Prodigy.
So we're going to do a whole show tomorrow night talking about some of our favorite, fondest memories from 15 years ago, so that would have been 1985.
Wow, look at you with the year math.
I don't know if that's right.
Always 95. Really bad with year math. I'm always really bad with that. I think that's going to be a blast.
I think I just failed in year math, actually.
We just got 1995.
Yeah.
we just got a whole bunch of cool stuff that we almost scrapped this entire show before the show and went with it. One of the reasons to tune in over at jupiterbroadcasting.com/live around 9 p.m. Pacific is, tune in before that, because we generally have a pre-show of some type going. Mm-hmm. Sometimes a more official pre-show, that's usually Monday and Wednesdays. But we usually hang out with you guys. If you're watching a live stream, you usually get about an hour and a half's worth of content.
Yeah, instead of the 15 minutes that you get on YouTube.
Well, and speaking of that, I think we'll choose this spot right here to wrap it up. But we hope you can join us tomorrow night. And until then, thanks for watching this episode of Jupiter at Night.
Good night.